Welcome to Today with Audrey K. I am your host, Audrey K., and we're so glad you've joined us today. Today we have another very special guest because, as you know, all of our guests are special guests on Today with Audrey K. Today we have with us a Mr. Tyrone Haymore from the Robbins Historical Society Museum. Okay. Welcome, Mr. Haymore.
Thank you for letting me come. I appreciate that very much.
I appreciate you being here.
Thank you.
Now, I know you very well, and you are like one of the most knowledgeable men that I know. You know all things Robbins.
Yeah, Robbins. Okay,
you know,
great.
All things Robbins, you know, about the airport, the Robbins Airport, and the flight, the black pilots.
Mm-hmm.
Give me the name.
That became Tuskegee Airmen.
Tuskegee Airmen.
The man who founded the Black Airport was John C. Robinson and Cornelius Coffey.
Okay. We have so much to talk about.
Right.
What should we talk about first?
Let's talk about the airport.
Okay, let's talk about the airport.
Because it is very important. A lot of people don't know, but the Robbins Airport was built in 1931 by two African-American men named John C. Robinson and Cornelius Coffey.
They built the airport?
Yes.
They designed it?
And they designed it, built it, owned it, and operated it, and completely. And this was the first black airport in the United States that was actually built, owned, and operated by black people.
Wow.
And it turned out later that they would train some of the first men who would become Tuskegee Airmen.
Wait a minute, so they built the airport, designed the airport, and then turned around and trained?
Yes.
The people to? Mm-hmm.
Well, there's a story before this happened. They actually had to learn how to fly themselves. They were auto mechanics to begin with.
Oh, wow.
Both men were auto mechanics. They were both born in 1903, which is also the year that aviation was born with the Wright brothers.
Mm.
They both were from the South, and they both migrated to the North, to Chicago and to Detroit, because they were educated in auto mechanics.
Okay.
So naturally, if you, in those days, in the 20s and the 30s, if you got a degree in auto mechanics, you made your way to where automobiles were made, Detroit, where you could exercise your skills and get the best dollar for your working hour.
Mm-hmm.
So these two men met in Detroit.
Okay.
And they found out that they had so much in common, beside the fact that they were both born in 1903.
Mm-hmm.
In 1926, I believe, I might be a little off on the date, the news headlines was that Bessie Coleman, the world's first black woman pilot, had died in a plane accident. And these guys read about it, and they said, you know, aviation is something that I would like to pursue too. And he said, is that your dream? So the other one said, yeah, they both agreed that they both wanted to get into aviation. Well, Robinson knew that there was an aviation school in Chicago called the Curtis Wright Aeronautical University, which was located at 1340 South Michigan Avenue in Chicago.
Really?
But they encountered the same problem that Bessie Coleman had with discrimination.
Oh, okay.
When they wrote and they sent their money in, made that application, but when they showed up at the school, and it was observed that they were colored or black, they were denied. They said that we don't take Negroes into our school.
I wonder, I just don't understand the whole idea of racism and discrimination, because it just makes no sense on one hand, and then on the other hand, it's about, I don't know, is it born out of fear or what, that another group of people would think it's necessary to keep another group of human beings down. Mm-hmm. So I don't understand this. I can imagine how they felt, you know, after they showed up. That I guess they probably suspected that's what would happen once they got there, when they actually showed up after turning in their application.
Yeah.
Now, were they the only two people?
At that time. And what happened, they were very upset, very angry about it, and Coffey decided he was going to talk to somebody about maybe filing a lawsuit for discrimination. But on their way out of the building, at the door was a bulletin board that had a bulletin up offering a job for a janitor in the building.
Okay.
Robinson Nelson, he said, a janitor, they're looking for a janitor. He said, I wonder, do they hire blacks to be janitors? So he
probably
went back to the desk and he inquired if they hired blacks, could blacks work in there as the janitors?
Mm-hmm.
They said, oh yeah, sure. You want to put in for that job? Put in for it. So he did. He put in for it.
So he had all this education and he put in for a janitor
job. For the janitor job.
How many people these days would do that?
Yeah.
It's like they have a lot of education. The last thing they're going to do, I believe a lot of people starve to death
with
that education before they put in for a janitor's job. But he had a reason. He had a plan. We need plans, people. Go ahead. I'm
he
sorry.
Knew that if he could just get in that building and could see something, could listen to hear something, or watch the instructors, that he could learn that way.
Wow.
And sure enough, they gave
smart.
Him the job as a janitor, and he began to sweep up the classrooms and empty the garbage and polish the windows. And all while he was doing it, he was eavesdropping on the classroom instructor, instructing the students how to build airplanes and how aviation works.
Wow.
And one
how
day,
smart is that?
Yeah. And one day he found a magazine that was in the garbage can, and this magazine was about how to build your own airplane. Now he would gather all those papers, instead of throwing them out, he would gather all these papers and take them home to his apartment, and he would study them.
You talk about divine order.
Yeah.
You talk about divine order. I mean, go ahead. So
he's
got these papers.
And he found in the garbage, he found a book that said that you could order a little small plane that was called a Heath Parasol that
mm-hmm.
was actually made here in Chicago.
Mm-hmm.
And the only thing is, the plane didn't come with an engine. It would come with the frame, the fuselage, the wings, and what have you. And if you can read and understand what you read, and you could put that together, and knew how to find a motor to go in it, it would fly. So he took it to his automotive garage on 47th near Indiana, to his buddies there, and he ordered the kit because the small plane was cheaper, so they took the little money they had and ordered the kit. The kit came, they began to assemble it together. Now you gotta remember, at this time, whites actually didn't think blacks could, if they could read, they were just calling words, but they didn't comprehend what they read.
Oh,
they
no.
literally thought blacks
now
were
this
bad.
Is in the 20s, the 30s.
Yeah, in the 20s and 30s, in the, you know, the Jim Crow eras. So the so that was the thinking. But these guys took the book, they got the kit, they began to put the plane together, and they had done it. Mm-hmm. Now the only problem was the motor.
Mm-hmm.
They said, well, it didn't come with a motor, but what kind of motor would we put in here to make this fly? Johnny Robinson, from his automotive training.
Now, had the Wright brothers, had they flown yet at
oh,
this
yeah,
time?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
They had flown at
yeah,
this time.
Yeah, they flown in 1903.
Yeah.
We're in
oh,
1920.
Yeah, that's okay,
now, yeah.
okay, yeah, okay.
So,
I'm back.
The plane, the kit was put together, and so Johnny Robinson, from his automotive training, knew that a plane that size, the weight, he put all those numbers together, and that would help him determine what kind of engine should make it fly.
Mm-hmm.
And he came up with some numbers that indicated that a motorcycle engine could probably do the job. And guess what? He happened to have a motorcycle.
Wow.
So he pulled the motorcycle engine out of the motorcycle and retrofitted it to fit the airplane. Now, you got to remember, they put the plane together, they built it, now they found an engine that they could put in it. But the question is, will it fly?
Will it fly?
Will it fly?
That's the question.
Now, Johnny Robinson befriended a white student, one of the more brighter white students at this school. He said, why don't you come out to my garage? I built an airplane. I want you to look at it. He said, you did what? He said, I built an airplane. He said, you did? Well, this I got to see. So he goes out to 47 feet and looks at this airplane, and he looks and says, you guys actually built this? And he examines the fuselage, the rudders, the cables, the dials. Everything looked perfect. He said, I can't believe you guys did this.
Wow.
He said, but the question again is,
will it fly?
He said, well, can you also fly this plane that you built? And he required, no, we can't. That's why we got you here.
Wow.
Talking to the white guy.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
So he said, well, I'm not going to fly this thing that you black guys build either. It might kill me. I might, you know,
oh
it may
my
not
goodness.
Work. You know.
I don't blame him, though. I mean, I don't care. I mean, you're talking about going up in the air with something that people you, it's like, how did you get this knowledge? Yeah. How did you get this information? And now you want me to get myself in this plane.
Yeah,
but this and place, I don't understand where you got this information from in the first place. And anyway, go ahead.
But this white student was very impressed. So he said, okay, okay, well, how do we get it out of this garage and get it somewhere we
want? Oh, he agreed. Okay.
Yeah, they agreed to get it, move it out of the garage and took it over to Washington Field.
Washington Park?
Washington Park, yeah. That's here now.
Uh-huh.
And sure enough, they got it there, they gassed it up, and the white student got inside the plane and he said, well, it starts up okay. I'm going to taxi around, see if it moved around the ground. So he moved around the ground. It moved like an airplane should on the ground.
Oh, wow. This is so exciting.
And he turned around, come back. So everybody said, yeah. Everybody was happy. Okay, now get it up in the air. And he was still a little leery. He said, okay. So he got a running start and in Washington Park on a grassy plane. And he took off. And that plane sailed into the sky just like any other airplane.
Oh, wow.
And shouting, the joy that they were exercising, that they had. And actually, as little as they know, they had made history just at that point. Because that was a point where a plane was built by blacks that actually flew.
Wow.
That's a history mark.
Is that not?
And the plane landed.
Can we find that information in the history books
because you won't see too much of it
taught
right now.
That when I was in school.
It's coming out now, but you know, like anything.
You should write a book. Are you writing a book? You should write a book.
Yeah, but it'll be a while for mine to come up. But there's some that are written out now. There's some now out, some very good ones called The Brown Condor by Thomas Simmons.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a new one that just came out last year in March, which now names Johnny Robinson. This guy names him the father of the Tuskegee Airmen.
Do they have a pic? Do you have a picture of the airplane?
Yeah, yes, we do. In fact, it's with the big picture we have. It's a little small plane in the middle. That's Johnny Robinson we're looking at now.
Oh, okay.
And there's if we can see a picture of the airport, the plane
airport?
In the middle, the little small plane in the middle. They actually brought it to Robbins.
There we are.
Now, if we can see, zoom in the middle there, you'll be able to see the little small airplane that they actually built.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, there it is.
Oh, is that the one that was flown?
Yeah, it's two planes in there. It's a large one, and then there's a little small one that's right there where the guys are stooping.
Mm-hmm.
That's the little plane in the back. That's the plane that they built at the garage at 47th in Indiana that flew.
Wow.
Now, what led us from this point? The white student went back to the school and told the white authorities this. Say, hey, you know those black guys you guys wouldn't let into the school as to learn how to fly? They done built their own airplane. They said, what? Yeah, but did it fly?
The question is,
did
it fly?
He said, yeah, it flew. He said, well, they taught themselves how to fly too? No, well, how did it fly? I flew it. White guy told them
that. Right.
He flew it.
Uh-huh.
And of course, they looked at him a little strange when he said that. They said that, well, if they built an airplane and the plane flew, and you can testify to that, why are we keeping them out of school? That doesn't make any sense.
Good.
Get them in here, because one of them is planning on filing a lawsuit against us anyway. So get them in here. We're going to talk to them.
See, that's what I'm saying. The thing is that it takes two races to overcome. It takes all races to overcome.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, the restrictions of just illogical prejudice.
Mm-hmm.
It's like it makes no sense.
Mm-hmm.
And with the black guys and the white guys, they had to decide to come together. The black guys had to decide that, okay, I'm gonna talk to this, you know, to this white guy because I know that he has something that, you know, that will be valuable to us.
Right.
You know, and the white guy, he came out and he gave the black guys their props because he actually got in there and flew the plane.
Yes, right.
So, and then he took it back to people who could do something about it, which happened to be the white guy at the school
who
said, well, why are we keeping it out?
Mm-hmm.
See, this is a pattern here that's good for everybody.
Yes,
now, how did it get to Robbins? Let's talk. How did he get to Robbins?
Well, this is interesting. The instructors agreed to if Coffey would call off his lawsuit.
So he had actually filed
yeah,
it.
Yeah, he was filing the lawsuit.
Okay.
And Coffey agreed to that they would be admitted to the school, but they could not let them mix with the white population. They said that they would have to come to a night school class, that they would set up a private class just for the two of them, and it would be at night.
Isn't that strange now when you think about it? It's like, that is
just
so strange.
Yeah, but it got them in there. That's the point.
Right, that's the point. It got them in there.
And they began to study. They were assigned, each one of them was assigned to separate airports for their actual flight training. And but all their mechanical and ground school training was done at the school on Michigan Avenue. And these guys did exceptionally well, and they did it in record time. Now, the reason they did that is because these men had automotive background. It's not a whole lot of difference between automotive mechanics and aviation mechanics.
Really?
So they understood pistons, firing, and combustion.
How many of, you know, our young men that's just kind of gifted, you know, mechanically inclined, that could actually, you know, move into another area,
sure,
like aviation.
Absolutely.
I think that should be encouraged.
Yeah.
You know, because we need, well, you know, people need to exercise their gifts where they are. So if they are mechanically inclined, that is something that could, you know, that that they should look into. But
well,
go ahead. So
Coffey and Robinson
soon
graduated from the school with flying colors. They did so well in such record time, the school actually turned around and made another history move with them by hiring them to be instructors, the first black instructors, at the Curtis Wright Aeronautical University in Chicago.
Get out!
Yeah, that happened.
Really?
Yes. And told them that you can invite your friends, your colored friends, to come and learn aviation, and you can teach them, and we will assist you.
Mm-hmm.
So one instructor was named Mr. Snyder. He was the main one, I think, and they began to train the guys that was in this garage. And that, you see them on the picture that we have there. That most of those were guys that worked in this automotive garage who he later trained, including the two women who happened to be Janet Bragg and Doris Tanner.
Wait a minute. Two women?
Two women were involved, too, in that first class that was taught.
Were they white or black?
No, black. They were all black.
Okay, I thought they were. Because you know how it was back then. Women, they had problems, too.
Oh,
so
yeah.
It's like, okay, you want it, we'll put you in with the.
Yeah.
Okay, so.
But then they, while they were teaching the blacks in the class, the white students were hearing about this, and they were still creating some problems. They were making racial problems for the blacks that was attending the school at night, even though they were separate. So Coffey and Robinson said, look, we don't have to put up with this. We have the credentials now. We have the knowledge. We have the know-how. We have everything we need to start our own aviation school. This is what Bessie Coleman was going to do also before her death, her untimely death. So they said, we're going to take up where Bessie Coleman left off, because she had to go to France to learn how to fly because of this discrimination in this country that wouldn't allow blacks to learn aviation.
Was she rich? I know this is a stupid question, but how did she get to France? Was she rich? I mean, how did she?
Well, I think her story is well documented. No, she wasn't rich. She got there through Mr. Abbott, the man who published the Defender newspaper. He actually paid for her to go to France to even learn French and take aviation lessons, and she did exceptionally well. She got a license. And she came back to the United States, this time to raise money to build an aviation school where she would teach blacks to fly and they wouldn't have to worry about discrimination.
I told you this man knows so much. I told you he knew so
well,
much.
Well, anyway,
so
Coffey and
Robinson. We're trying to get to the Robbins Airport.
Yeah. Robinson and Coffey decided that they had enough of the racial problems with the students and the instructors, that they had all the credentials they need to start their own aviation training school. They went to the Chicago authorities to ask for permission to build an airport and an aviation school. But guess what? The politicians discriminated against them too and would not allow them a permit to build a separate aviation school. But they heard about an all-black town just 17 miles southwest of Chicago called Robbins, Illinois.
Okay.
They had a black mayor, a black police chief, a black fireman, black judges. Everything was black. They said, well, let's go out there. And if they don't let us build an airport, then we can't go anywhere.
Oh, wow.
And sure enough, when they went to Robbins, They met with the mayor, who was Mayor Thomas J. Keller, the first mayor of Robbins, and he enthusiastically said, now we will not only permit you to build, we're going to help you build the airport.
You know what?
And Robbins Airport was built with citizens and volunteers who cut down the trees, brought in the lumber,
wow,
and they built that airport.
You know what?
In 1931.
I have one thing that I just want to say right here, right now. Racism is evil. Nobody wins.
Yes.
Okay, and back to you. I just wanted to say that, you
absolutely
know, just, but, and so then that's how the Robbins Airport
got there.
Now, how did you become so interested in all things Robbins? How did that happen for you?
Well, it really was the airport. I had lived in Robbins all my life, and I had never, now there is an airport near Robbins in Crestwood. And whenever this lady named Miss Eddie Lou Allen, who was the, started the Robbins Historical Society, she was the original founder, she would be telling people about the airport in Robbins, but she was a little tied-tongued, so a lot of people didn't give her a lot of credence.
Mm-hmm.
And some even thought she was kind of a little out of her head, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But she knew about the airport because she witnessed it, and she took rides in the airplanes with Robinson and Coffey,
mm-hmm,
like a lot of people did at that time.
Mm-hmm.
Well, she would go around talking about that. Well, that's what got my attention. I say, are you talking about, where is this airport? She said, the airport was here in Robbins on Lawndale Avenue.
Mm-hmm.
I said, here in Robbins? I said, but it's just one right up the street on Pulaski there.
Oh, wow. Okay.
She said, no, no, baby, that's the white man's airport. We had a black airport right here in Robbins. I said, you have to take me and show me the ground where this
was. Wait, Tyrone.
Okay.
We got like 3 minutes.
Okay.
And I don't know where the time went. Is that all we have? Just three. Okay.
All right.
So let's talk about just some of the, that's in your museum,
yeah,
some of the people who are highlighted in your museum.
In our museum, we did our museum because not only did we have the first black airport built in Robbins, Illinois in 1931, but we have a number of individuals, movie stars and actors like Nichelle Nichols from Star Trek that was born and raised in Robbins. Dwayne Wade, the basketball player from Robbins. Mr. T is from Robbins. Even though he grew up in Chicago, they started in Robbins.
Oh, wow.
And we also have Mr. S.B. Fuller, who was America's first black multimillionaire. Not first millionaire, but he was the first black multimillionaire who made his fortune selling soap and cosmetics, which he learned by reading a book. But he did this with a sixth grade education and $25.
Wow.
And he was, and he had, at one
now,
time, he had over 6,000 employees.
Now we have,
mm-hmm,
now we have, we are so educated,
right,
and we have more money than they did back then. Why do you think, what's hindering us? And if you can give me like a 1 minute, just what you think it is.
Well, I'll tell you in the words of Mr. Fuller, desire.
You don't think
we
desire?
Lack desire. He said when he was a kid, he asked his mother, why did God make us so poor? She slapped him in the face and she said, don't you ever say God made us poor. We're poor because your father never had a desire to be rich.
Oh, wow.
And he said that changed his life. Desire.
Wow.
If you desire something, you go after it with everything you got.
With something that's happening to the desire of, you know,
yeah,
of our people and,
mm-hmm,
people in,
mm-hmm,
general. But I just want to say it was so great talking to you. You know, I can talk to you all day long.
Yeah, well, invite me back and I'll tell you the rest of the story.
I will invite you back and you'll tell me the rest of the story.
We have some incredible people that have come out of Robbins.
So where's the location? Let's get the location of your museum.
The Robbins Museum is open every Saturday from 12 to 5. It's located at 3644 West 139th Street. Or at the corner of 139th and Lawndale Avenue.
And you
in
do
Robbins,
tours
Illinois.
And you come out and give demonstrations and talk about all this this kind of stuff.
Oh, and the mission is free.
And
by the way.
Yeah, so that you can't beat that.
Right.
Okay, so everybody, you need to get out there. You wanna have some knowledge on your head. Tyrone Haymore, he will put some knowledge on your head. So we just like to just join you and remind you to go to our website, intothelightsite.com, and see what we have coming up. We have a lot of great things. We're going to do a fiery destination. So if you missed the first one, you can see the second one. And if you have any questions that you would like to ask me or to ask Haymore, you can actually write me at Audrey K. Today haymore@gmail.com. So we look forward to hearing from you. And Haymore, it's always a pleasure.
Same here.
It's always a pleasure.
Thank you very much.
Thank you
for having me. Appreciate it.
Okay.